What's up, Degenerate Nation? Welcome to the Big Bets on Campus podcast presented by BetMGM. This is the NCAA tournament weekend betting recap and Sweet 16 quick preview. I'm stuck in joining me today. I'm our BBOC fellow co-host, Greg Waddell and Mike Calabrese. Gentlemen, today we will recap what happened over the weekend and then just quickly peek ahead to the Sweet 16. We will have a pair of episodes previewing those games, each game in depth. The three-man weave will have an episode, and then me, Calabrese, and Mike Randall will also have an episode that we'll record on Wednesday. But let's talk about the weekend that was a little March blandness, more chalk than your teacher's drawer. In not a lot of upsets, but usually, I will say, that makes for better later rounds is what I'm hoping for. We basically have all the top seeds and the ACC. That's basically the Sweet 16. Greg, I'll throw it to you. What was a couple of your key takeaways from the weekend?
Well, gentlemen, I am so excited that we don't have to have the parody conversation again like last year. I know we all love madness. What I love more than madness is watching the best teams in the sport play for national championships. I was at the Final Four last year. Let me tell you, unquestionably, this is a pure rant, guys. I hated it. It was horrible. I hated pretending that that Miami team was some special team worthy of a serious run. I hated pretending like San Diego State and Florida Atlantic were top 15 teams in the sport at the end of the year. We just drew teams out of a hat, and that's what we got stuck with, and UConn did what the one good team should do to the other three. They eviscerated them. This year, it's going to be a lot more interesting. There are three elite teams in college basketball. All three have made it to the Sweet 16. Two are firing on all cylinders, and Houston survived against a Texas A&M team that was game for a challenge last night. But man, I'm impressed with all the teams from the two line down to the five line that have taken care of business as well. Yes, do I wish we would have had a little more underdog love? Of course, I was on a bunch of them on Sunday. But to be honest with you, I'll take some losses over the weekend if it means we get this Sweet 16. These games are going to be competitive. There's going to be games that are really just like, can you get the right read on which team is better here between two top 10 opponents, which from a bettor's perspective, I love, because I feel like by this point in the season, we should know who these teams are. And it's just picking them at this point based on matchup more than drawing random teams out of a hat. So I'm very excited for it. I think it's good for the sport. It's a nice bounce back after what we had to go through last year.
Yeah, I will give a ton of credit to Houston. I mean, they're among the one seeds. They had the toughest task, and they survived despite having four starters foul out, which is the first time that has happened since, I believe, 1987 in the NCAA tournament. So, yeah, that was a pretty wild game. One of the few really exciting games of the weekend where the favorites went 15-1 straight up. Not the best, but though, over the past 5 years. In 2019, in the second round, the favorites went 16-0 on the money line. In that year, Virginia got its redemption national title the year after losing in the first round to a 16 seed. Now we have a chalky second round. Does Purdue get its national title and its redemption tour season to mirror what happened that year? But Calabrese, I'll go to you. What were some of your key takeaways or one thing you wanted to highlight from the weekend?
Two things. The first, can we get like a constitutional amendment to work out not getting screwed in double overtime, catching 5.5 points? Because listen, I had the
under there. I had the under. The first half under was lost on a buzzer beater, and the full game under, which lost in double overtime. It was fine in overtime, and then we needed to go to double overtime. And then anyone with Oregon covering the entire game until the second overtime, absolutely miserable. I also had some Oakland money line before then, and some Oakland plus six. I didn't get a good number there. So yeah, overtimes were pretty cruel this year. But go ahead. Yeah, the constitutional amendment, I'm all for it.
Yeah, I also gave out Oakland's. There were some pushes. I hit my 6.5. But as you always say, Stuck, you want everybody to, you know, to cash in those situations. There's a few buddies who got somehow the worst possible number. They got 5.5. It's just insanity. I've always thought this. I think I'm in the super minority on this. I feel like 5 minutes is too long for OT in college, just in general. Not because underdogs go
spoken
to die.
Like a true underdog, better.
Yes, but just in general, I always feel
30-second overtime.
Like, let's go 90 seconds. I feel like
sudden
that's
death. Sudden death. I'm all for sudden death.
3-point shooting contest, whatever it takes to get us out of there quicker. So there was that. Also, I want to echo what you guys are bringing up, which is this national champion now, because everything was so chalky in the round of 32, it's no longer your path. It's, you know, everyone's going to have to beat multiple good teams from here on out to win the national championship. And it is frustrating because there are multiple years in which I look at the bracket by the end of it, the national champion, and by luck and happenstance, they get 3 or 4 wins over teams that are barely top 25, where that's not going to happen this time. And the last point I want to make, I'm going to keep riding UConn laying big numbers because I think that Hurley's onto something. He's really kind of playing the narrative in the same way that Kirby Smart did during their repeat year, where somehow, despite being world beaters and having all this talent and drubbing teams, both he personally and his team think that they are undervalued and they have a chip on their shoulder. I don't know if you saw Hurley's post-game interview. He's calling out the committee. It's like, you didn't have to play A&M. Like, there was better 8-9 teams that made it and played over the weekend than the team that you faced.
You played a 2-man Northwestern team.
Right, but like, he really believes it. I don't even think it's like shtick. I think he's like so psychotic that he's like, the whole universe is against us, and somehow they're playing that card. And for that reason, they get like an extra bump in terms of like being bloodthirsty and just absolutely drubbing teams. So it pains me to say, but like, kudos to him. I think it's like a difficult sell inside a locker room, in the same way that Kirby Smart, I don't know if you remember, one of his linebackers was like, everybody said we were going to go 7-5. It's like, on what planet did anyone say you were going 7-5 after winning the national championship? But so much of that is like the mental aspect between the ears. And I think UConn has it right now. So to go into TD Garden up in Boston for a de facto home game, like, I wouldn't want to be San Diego State, and I certainly won't be taking the 10.5 with the Aztecs.
Yeah. I will say, yeah. Now, by the way, that's the third national title rematch since the tourney, and then following year, since the tourney expanded in 1985. Duke UNLV, 1992. Happened in the Final Four. Florida UCLA 2007 also happened in the Final Four. This will be the third, with UConn taking on San Diego State in the Sweet 16. San Diego State, by the way, they just played in Spokane, finish, you know, after midnight Eastern time on Sunday, and then they get a Thursday game across the country to take on UConn. Not the most ideal travel was, but you know, it's 3 days off. It's, you know, 3 full days off in between, but something worth noting. I'll throw a rant out there. A couple teams that hit, like, make your free throws. Grand Canyon, I mean, give me a break, Grand Canyon. You miss 17 free throws and you shoot 2 of 20 from three. There's going to be a lot of talk about Alabama's defensive resurgence. That's all it was. Is Grand Canyon couldn't hit a shot or a free throw. They were 2 of 20. With 13 missed free throws and had the lead with 4 minutes to go against Alabama. They're a great free throw shooting team. So I don't understand what happened there. I don't know if it's the ball. Some of these teams, what happened with Drake in free throw shooting? But the Grand Canyon melt, they end the game giving up a 10-0 run, 17-3 run over the final 5 minutes. What killed them was they couldn't make their free throws, and then Bama missed a bunch of free throws in a row and kept getting their offensive rebounds and kept getting fouled. 5-point play there killed the Grand Canyon momentum when they're up 2 with 5 to go, and then just wilted from there. But make your free, if you're a good free throw shooter, you make your free throws. Even the walk on for Houston could do it.
Has anyone checked the for profit? I know they're on the New York Stock Exchange. Are they dipping and not making the Sweet 16 in terms of their stock? Or I was wondering to see if they were going to get a nice little bump. Yeah, like, yeah,
we got an online for-profit Ponzi scheme in the tournament. Maybe there's some shadiness going on in the back end. But, yeah, they couldn't make a free throw or a three. Look, Bama's defense wasn't as bad as some people were saying over the final month because everyone was making threes. There's no resurgence for this Bama defense. They played Charleston, who started out 1 of 24 from three, or 1 of 17. And then they played Grand Canyon, who went 2 of 20 from three with 14 missed free throws. And it was a game down to the wire. So yeah, make your free throws. Greg, I'll throw it back to you. Anything stick out to you as far as conferences are concerned? You know, we got all three Big East teams go through. And as someone who had, I had a Houston future and a Texas A&M future, I was sad. Like, this is why you want a 10 or a 7, I think, over an 8 or 9. Like, Texas A&M is a team that could have done damage. I also still think St. John's is a team that could have done damage if they got in the field. So I was sad to see that. But all three Big East teams make it to the Sweet 16. But the ACC does it again. They've had a lot of success in the tournament. People are down on the conference during the year. And then look what we have here. We have all chalk, and then NC State and Clemson are your underdogs in the Sweet 16. Your Cinderellas are from the ACC, Duke, Carolina. I have to give credit to where my worst wrong game of the weekend was Michigan State against, credit to you guys for North Carolina. Hubert Davis, I have to give him props. 8-0 against the spread now in the NCAA tournament. But we had the Big East and the ACC, I think, had the most successful runs of the weekend. But anything that you want to add or bring up as far as conferences, Greg?
I think you hit the key points, and it is hard to come to terms with the fact that a man named Hubert is 8-0 against the spread in the NCAA tournament, but I'll get there at some point here. In general, my philosophy is that I don't think we should use tournament results as a way to validate conference strength. It's kind of like bowl games in college football, right? It's fun narratively. It's fun to dunk on fans of teams in other conferences if your conference does well. I get it. It's still a very small sample size compared to the 20-plus game conference schedules that we get to see these teams for over the course of the season. I will say, just quick hitters from me on conferences would be, yes, the ACC does it again. That's baffling to me because I don't believe NC State and Clemson are like great basketball teams. I think they are playing well right now, certainly. But to me, they're still two of the weakest teams in this draw. The Big East did get jobbed, but we knew that coming in. We also knew that the Big East was kind of a conference with three elite teams and then a bunch of a mess in the middle. I don't think it's a guarantee that because Creighton, Marquette, and UConn are all in the Sweet 16, that the teams on the bubble would have performed well in this tournament. I do think they deserve to get in, especially the ones that picked up wins against that group. But I wouldn't, you know, conflate that to, oh, I wish Providence was here. They would have made the Sweet 16. On the negative side here, there was a lot of talk of the Big 12 this year being the best conference in college basketball. In reality, I think a lot of teams in that conference had juiced up numbers metrically this year based on beating up teams that they scheduled that were in the 300s on KenPom. And we heard coaches from other conferences call them out in the middle of the season, like, hey, the Big 12 gamed the net rankings here. I think that holds pretty true here. Houston certainly is good. Kansas is hard to judge because of their injury situation, but a team like Baylor that was kind of circulating all year of, we don't know what they are, really got outplayed for 40 minutes by Clemson. I don't think that's a great look for the league. And everybody else on the lower levels here just didn't really perform here. And then the Mountain West, are we ever going to learn on the Mountain West? I mean, this was supposed to be the year of the Mountain West. And I mean, Colorado State won the play-in game. San Diego State moves on to the Sweet 16, but it's hard for me to look at a team like Utah State that I thought could pose some problems for Purdue lose in the fashion that they did, combined with Boise State's loss, New Mexico's no show. I mean, these aren't just losses, guys. These are some blowout performances from a conference that we all really enjoyed watching this year. And we thought was underseeded, right? And maybe that plays a part of this, but when our takeaway on Selection Sunday is like, wow, the Mountain West got jobbed, and then every team in the league except for San Diego State comes out and loses by 20, maybe they didn't get jobbed. Maybe they got exactly what they deserved.
Yeah, I will say in regards to Baylor, I mean, you mentioned small sample size. Most of these games, you know, unless the team is completely overmatched, but most of these games, most of the betting results, it just comes down to shooting variance. Baylor, 6 of 24 from 3. Clemson said, you got to beat us from 3. They're a 40% three-point shooting team. They couldn't make one. You have Walter going 5 of 11 from the line, too. They missed, I think, 11 free throws. Walter's an 80% free throw shooter, went sub 50%. So that really burnt Baylor in that game. You bring up the Mountain West. Yeah, the one non-altitude team, San Diego State. advances again. The rest of the altitude teams, which fit that narrative that everyone was talking about, are gone. And I will say, in regards to the ACC, yes, it's a small sample size, all of this stuff. But coming into the year, coming into this tournament, before this tournament, over the past three tournaments, they've had six Sweet 16 appearances, tied for second, make that 10 now. That's number one. Four Elite Eight appearances, which is the first. Three Final Four appearances, tops, and 6.3 wins over seed expectation, which is number one amongst all leagues. And that's with just the fourth most bids of any conference. So, yeah, it's not like they've had a ton of teams in, but they've just found ways to succeed and are doing so again. Calabrese, anything you want to add from a – and I'll agree with you. Like, we didn't need I don't necessarily think we needed Providence or Seton Hall in. I just had St. John's as a team with a super high ceiling, just like Colorado. Like, I believe Colorado can beat anybody. If they make a couple wide open threes into that game, they beat Marquette. And St. John's similar to me, top 20 team talent wise. That's why I wanted St. John's in. But Calabrese, I'll throw it to you. And I had a Final Four feature on St. John's from this podcast. So that's I have to push my agenda and narratives. Calabrese, anything you want to add from a league perspective?
Yeah, I kind of agree with Greg's assessment where too much is made, I would say, on the positive side, where sometimes, you know, you win a couple close games, you get one or two extra teams into the Sweet 16, and all of a sudden that validates the entirety of your league and the whole season. But I will say on the negative side, I think it kind of is a little bit true, where the Mountain West, what Nevada did and just kind of, you know, blowing that lead and the non-competitive nature of Colorado State's play. Yeah, I think I finally learned my lesson where this is just the way that it goes when they punch up in the tournament. And I think moving forward, I need to start viewing it as they need to prove it to me on a league-wide basis that they can beat these teams in March. Not that that's the be-all and end-all, but I think it's fair to put it there. And the other like storyline that I thought was a little interesting to me, we were kind of on Kansas. I played Samford a little bit on the money line on the spread. You know, they had a chance to upset them, and then you know, we saw what happened to them in the round of 32. It was a little bit surprising to me that Self, and I understand that he essentially has 100% job security. He can say whatever he wants, do whatever he wants. A little surprised he said the quiet part out loud, where he's like, yeah, I've just been looking forward to next season. This is a disaster. And the reason why I'm surprised that he said it is this is the new normal. Every year, your roster is going to get torn up. You're going to bring in new people. Sometimes the pieces are going to fit together. Sometimes they're not. It's clear he's excited to no longer be coaching Hunter Dickinson and having players who maybe could play say, oh, I care more about the NBA or I'm shutting it down. That's all fine. But like, that's the reason why you get paid millions and millions and millions of dollars. It is a fun job to be a basketball coach on the floor. What you're actually getting paid to do is all of the recruiting and roster management and locker room management. Like, that's the hard part. Everybody has elements of their job that they don't love. So I'm just surprised that he said that out loud, because I think in general, that could be kind of a negative recruiting pitch where it's like he essentially is admitting for the last, you know, month of the season that he was looking forward and this was kind of a lost cause for someone who has accomplished so much and is viewed so well in the coaching community. I was just a little bit surprised to hear him say that.
Yeah, definitely a sad way for Kansas to go out in that game. Credit to Gonzaga. I mean, Gonzaga could miss in the second half, but it also looked like Kansas just died down and eventually gave up. It looked like they just quit about 8 minutes in to that second half. All right, let's go through the teams that are left. We have in the East, UConn San Diego State rematch, the 1-5, and then the 2-3, Illinois Iowa State. Greg, I'll throw it to you for the East. Just a quick thought, like, is you assume UConn's going to get through San Diego State? Who poses is the Illinois offensive upside the bigger threat to UConn? Iowa State's defense is so much better than Illinois, and Illinois, I fear for their rim defense against UConn, and Illinois is playing better. Danger gives them like more versatility. But they did just beat, you know, Morehead State and Duquesne. I don't want to completely overreact to Brad Underwood now, but I would think the Illinois offensive upside gives them a better chance against UConn. But then again, like Iowa State would turn it into a street fight. So curious to get your just quick thoughts on the East.
Yeah, I think it is Illinois that poses the bigger problem. And I'll say this. I think Illinois-Iowa State is going to be the game to watch in the Sweet 16. Just the contrast of styles. Both teams have an argument. Yeah, I mean, but both teams have an argument that they're playing as good as anybody in the country outside of UConn and Purdue right now. I mean, Iowa State, with the way they ran through the Big 12 tournament, the way that defense is performing, the offense has sort of flipped the switch back on. And I think Illinois thinks they're a completely new team over the last week and a half compared to who they were for much of the Big Ten season. And I think they might be right if they believe that. Look, there is no team in the country outside of maybe UConn that has the star power Illinois has, period. Like Terrence Shannon and Marcus Damask and Coleman Hawkins as a three-headed monster stacks up with the very best teams in the country. And I don't think you can get in a rock fight with UConn. And maybe I'm wrong on this. I think if you try to get in a rock fight with UConn, it probably looks the way the national championship game did last year, where you hang within 10 points, and San Diego State will try to do that again. We'll see what happens in the Sweet 16. But to me, UConn's just too good. They're too solid. They get whatever they want at the rim. They get wide open threes. That's not going to change even against a great defense. And you have to have the offensive firepower to at least stick with them. If you'd want a game in the 50s against UConn, good luck. And to me, I think Iowa State could really struggle to score the ball. We've seen that offense go cold for 8 minute stretches. They did that in the first 10 minutes of their round of 32 game, and it almost cost them against Washington State. And it was mostly self-inflicted from what I saw. I don't think Washington State was necessarily locking them up. It was just kind of a dry spell. So the interesting thing with that matchup for me is that Illinois, like, that's when they have struggled this year, is when teams do slow the pace down. And we saw Matt Painter be very deliberate in the game in Champaign and say, let's keep this in the 60s. And it worked, and it wore them down over the course of the game. Shannon never got going at all. So to me, Iowa State may have the advantage in that game, but if Illinois can find a way to get through that, I think that game against UConn could be an all-timer with the way Shannon's playing right now, guys. Like, I know Edie's doing generational one-of-one things, getting double-doubles in the first half, but Shannon's tournament run right now feels special, like historically special. He's just – you can pencil him in for an automatic 30 points a game right now, and he's not even their closer. Like, Damask is their go-to guy, and Coleman Hawkins is one of the most versatile pieces in the country. I love where this team is at. The numbers say their defense is a lot better too, by the way. It's, again, it's a small sample size, only a week and a half, but – 5-game sample, they've gone from in the 200s defensively, where they were for much of the Big Ten season, up to 74th in the country. And Stuck, I know you called it out pre-tournament. Like, teams with that profile are good teams to circle and think they can lose early. I think Illinois survived that, one, because they got fortunate with the Duquesne draw in the round of 32. But two, because this defense is making a significantly more concerted effort than it was for much of the Big Ten season, just eye test-wise to me right now. And it's not like they haven't had good defenders, guys. That's the thing. Terrence Shannon is an impact defender. Coleman Hawkins is an impact defender. For whatever reason, they just weren't dialed in on that end for much of the year. It looks noticeably better to me, and it gives them hope that they could actually make a Final Four.
And moving on to the – yeah, I mean, just to circle back, I would agree with that. I think that you need the offensive firepower to beat UConn. I also just don't, but I still don't think that Illinois has, their defense is playing better. There's more effort, even though, you know, it's against Duquesne, who's arguably should have been a 13 or 14 seed, and Morehead State, another 14 seed. You know, this is a team that still gave up 90 to Wisconsin a week ago. I still don't think they have national title defensive upside, especially at the rim. But if they can put together, you know, 90 to 100, they only got to win 4 games, even though we have hardly ever seen it in the past. With
the interesting thing with that matchup too, Stuck, is like, what would happen to Klingon? Because I agree, like, in theory, Klingon should get whatever he wants at the rim, but there is a chance that Illinois spaces it out so much offensively and Klingon can't guard the perimeter. Like, if they go 5 out with Hawkins, like, what does Hurley do to pull the strings there? Does he just say, okay, race to 90, we're going to get all our points at the rim, make you beat us from 3? But I think that is a concern. Like, I don't know if Klingon has necessarily had to guard in space on the perimeter, and that would be a lot tougher for me than the traditional bigs of Iowa State.
I would just say that Shannon's not going to be able to get, you know, they can, UConn can lock him up more than most teams on the perimeter. I mean, look what they did to Boo Booey, and Shannon's not going to be able to just get to the rim at will against that D. But it is interesting with the big man and how Klingon would be played in that matchup. And then Danger, I will say Danger gives Illinois like just a different flavor and, you know, more physicality and more versatility when they need that type of lineup. He's been huge of late in certain games, especially when they have needed him. But Calvary, sorry, what were you going to say?
Oh, just real quick. I have two quick looks for the East. I think because of the travel schedule and the psychological barrier of getting boat race in the title game last year and playing in front of a super partisan crowd up in Boston, I'm more interested in laying the 6 in the first half. UConn also, you know, just for the record, during the season, multiple games, slow starts out of the gate, kind of going through the motions a little bit, and then they'd fire themselves up. As I mentioned, Hurley's pulling all the right strings. They, you know, did not allow Stetson a second to breathe. They, you know, race out and crush him early, do the same thing against Northwestern. So I'm interested in laying the 6 in the first half with the Huskies. And on the other side with Illinois and Iowa State, I think this is binary. I think it's going to go one of two ways. Either Iowa State imposes their will and they get that rock fight and they can play in the 60s, and Illinois' defense and their issues in the half court and at the rim, I think, rear their head. Or, and this is the side I'm going to play, Illinois succeeds for the third straight game, gets teams into a track meet. And for that reason, I want to go alt line. I'll lay the 3 on the other side with Illinois and you get 2-1 on your money. I think that it's far more likely if they play this game in the high 70s that Iowa State is totally incapable of playing at that pace and scoring that efficiently for 40 minutes. So laying 3 on the other side on the alt line, I think, is a way to increase value on a bet like that.
Calabrese with his weekly, daily, indirect Lipsy slander. Moving on to the West, which is, you have two ACC teams, North Carolina and Clemson. If they both win, they'll play each other. But first, North Carolina is skipped by Alabama, and Clemson will take on Arizona. I will say, in regards to Arizona, wasn't super impressed against Dayton. You know, Dayton had a chance there at the end. They missed, Holmes missed two huge front ends on back-to-back possessions. Arizona, in between that, well, off of one front end miss, they get out in transition, get a 3. Holmes misses another front end. Arizona gets fouled, misses a front end. It gets tipped out for a 3. Basically like a 10-point swing in 30 seconds. It was pretty wild. I wasn't super impressed with Arizona. Now, what Clemson is going to do is what they've done to the first two teams that they played, who had way superior backcourts, right? New Mexico, Baylor. They said, beat us from 3. Right, like softer D, zone-ish, beat us from 3, and neither could. Arizona could, but I feel like Arizona's going to be forced into a ton of bad shots here. And is Caleb Love on? If so, Arizona moves on. Is Caleb Love cold? Clemson definitely has a shot here. They have, you know, Hall could pull Ballo away from the rim. And by the way, I think Ballo, his defense is going to be the death of Arizona, like a team that could pull him out. You saw Dayton pretty much play him off the court for long stretches in pick and roll. Clemson's going to have a shot there. It's going to come down to Arizona shooting, right? But I feel like they can coax Arizona into a lot of bad shots and keep that game in the half court. And then North Carolina, Alabama. Alabama's got a shot because their games are 3-point variance. And if their threes are going, they have a shot against North Carolina. So I'm curious to get, Greg, do you have any one or two quick thoughts in the West?
Yeah, my quick thought is we're one game away from Caleb Love against North Carolina with the Final Four on the line. Just narratively, like, can we please make that happen? That would be the most fun thing to watch. Look, I think if I was to predict which underdog is more likely to get something done here, I think I lean Clemson. Now, as you mentioned, Alabama can just disrupt whatever prediction you have if they pour it in and shoot 60% from three. I never feel comfortable betting against Alabama, but I like your points on Balo being the problem defensively, and Clemson's bigs both will step out and shoot it, right? PJ Hall's not afraid to shoot four or five threes in a game, and Shefflin's shooting 50% on 41 attempts. So I love the way this Clemson team is playing right now. They're kind of living up to the promise we were hopeful for all season. Just the inconsistencies along the way and a lot of close losses during the regular season bit them. Chase Hunter looks like a totally different dude too right now. Like, he's just more confident in some of the shot attempts he's taking, like transition threes, things we've seen him be tentative on all season.
We mentioned that during the regular season. Like, if he's on and hitting shots, they're a different team.
Totally different team. Yeah. And my initial impression, I think that line's at 6.5, 7 right now. That seems high for me from what I've seen from Clemson through a week. I'm probably going to stay away from UNC Alabama, to be honest, but I do think Alabama is running on some borrowed time right now in this tournament. Like, the fact that Grand Canyon almost stole that game, despite how poorly they shot from free throw and three, is not a good sign for where this Alabama
Breitzel got hurt too again, which is like his fifth concussion.
Yeah.
And he's key.
Yeah. So, and we'll Baycott should devour that front court too. Like, it's kind of just to show up and be Armando game.
Yeah. And the Bama could throw the wrench in there by going 15 of 30 from three. And they'll get their looks against North Carolina, but yeah, it's going to be hard for Alabama to stop North Carolina at the rim. Calabrese, any thoughts in the West?
Yeah, just quick. I agree with the assessment on North Carolina's offense against Bama's defense. I think they're going to score 100 points. So I'm going to go over on the team total. I'm going to go over 173.5. Bama only knocked down 8 triples. No Reitzel, I think, makes them beyond questionable to play them against the spread against North Carolina, but I'm just more interested in the team total and over. And then Clemson, I agree. This is too many points. Considering, you know, beating New Mexico, beating Baylor, and PJ Hall scored 25 points in those two games. So we haven't even had a PJ Hall put the team on his back moment yet. So yeah, I'm just going to go ahead and take the points. I think they're a live dog as well.
All right. Transitioning over to the South, we have Houston after they survived with a zone defense and a walk-on hitting free throws in overtime in a crazy game against A&M, which they led by 10 with a minute to go, reminiscent of A&M's insane comeback against UNI, which they actually won in double overtime. This time they came up short. They will take on Duke, who dismantled James Madison. And then we have NC State, who just won't die. They're still alive. Easily could have lost to Oakland, but they survive. And in overtime, another overtime game there. NC State will take on Marquette. Marquette, one of the better games of the weekend. We didn't get many, but Marquette, Colorado was an awesome game. Just two offenses were clicking, firing on all cylinders. Marquette, you know, around a touchdown favorite against NC State. Houston, around a 4-point favorite against Duke. Duke looked fantastic, and people are going to be jumping on them now. I do still think that Houston's physicality is going to give them major issues, and just like North Carolina did. But on the flip side, this is where I'm going to spend most of my time in the next couple of days. Like, the teams that Duke also struggled with are the teams that got out in transition and killed them in fast-paced games. And this is going to be more of a grinder in the half court, which Duke is comfortable with. And I feel like more that's how they want to play. So that's an interesting dynamic. I don't think NC State can beat Marquette, but I mean, it's one game. So we'll see there. But anything that you want to mention in the South, Greg?
My gut first impression here, and we'll see if I talk myself out of it in 2 days. I think Duke can beat Houston. Now, you mentioned the physicality. I have this feel that the physicality could work against them, and we get a classic Duke whistle in this game. Like, we just saw Houston had to survive with a bunch of guys fouled out. Now, that game went to overtime, right? But we've talked all season about how Duke's kind of soft. Houston's going to get all over them. What if a couple guys pick up a quick fouls? Like, Houston fouls all the time. I could see that coming back to bite them against the Duke team that, it, quite frankly, flops a lot. Like, it puts pressure on the officials with the way Duke plays. And I think it will be a game where Houston is in the bonus very, very quickly. Duke's been awesome since March 1st, by the way. Like, I know the losses to North Carolina hang over the way people view this team, but they're fifth nationally since March 1st. They're really, really good. Like, they're just talented as hell. We've seen what McCain can do. He can catch fire and kind of single-handedly carry you. Filipowski can do the same. I also have some serious concerns for Houston, just given the injury situation. Now, Robert's line ended up looking pretty good in the Texas A&M game. I give him credit for playing through it, but he was visibly limping at multiple times in this game. He has a week to get ready for it now, but if he's not 100%, totally different team than they were earlier in the season with him and Tugler. And lastly, Houston is not good on the defensive boards, which is kind of crazy because they're such a good rebounding team in general and physical and tenacious, but like, they're very vulnerable there. And that's one thing Duke does pretty well. I thought Duke was destroying James Madison there early, really asserting their will physically in that game. It's going to be a different type of test. But, you know, if Flip and Mark Mitchell are crashing the boards against a team ranked in the 270s at preventing offensive rebounds, create some second chances. I don't know. If they get in the bonus early, I like the way this Duke team is playing. I think they actually have the better backcourt here. Jeremy Roach, a guy who started in the Final Four a couple years ago. I think there's value. Plus 154 is what I'm seeing at on the money line for Duke right now, and that's an early play for me.
Yeah, I will say that, I mean, yeah, Houston is vulnerable on there. I mean, their defense is so aggressive too, to the ball. They're going for steals, blocks, that it leaves them a little vulnerable on that side of the ball. Calabrese, anything here you want to mention?
As Greg was walking through that, I kind of came to this idea, and maybe it's a little bit crazy, and it wouldn't be reflected in the point spread. But I think I'd rather have Marquette against Duke than Houston against Duke because of the style of play. I really do think it, when you speed up Duke, we've seen it in the North Carolina games. That's how I want to attack them. And it's what Greg laid out. Underrated on the offensive glass. What did Houston just give up to A&M? Like 23 offensive rebounds? It was ridiculous. But the other part, the only thing that he didn't hit on was Duke's turnover rate is so low. And Houston defensively, it's not just, you know, turning turnovers into transition points, which they do, they're fine with that. They don't live and die with it, but it's more so the fact that they get stops by, you know, you don't even get a shot up. Duke, I think because they're so buttoned up in that regard, I think this is kind of a bad matchup. I think that the line's just about right. So this may be a pass for me, but interestingly, I'd just rather have Marquette against the Blue Devils than Houston.
All right. Then moving on to the Midwest, you have Purdue who just discarded Utah State. They will take on Gonzaga, who just blew out Kansas in the second half of that game. And then you have in the bottom half of the Midwest, you have Creighton, who per shot quality tied Akron. Akron missed their last 23 threes, I think, in that game, or 17 threes. And Creighton shot 60% from three. I think the shot quality score was like 63 all. And then Creighton should have lost to Oregon, let's be frank. They were down four with 30 seconds to go, and they somehow survived due to a missed free throw and some craziness, and then they end up covering in double overtime. But they will move on to take on Tennessee. By the way, our podcast bets, we cashed Houston to win the Big 12. We have three left. Tennessee, Houston, and Clemson to make the Final Four at, what, 28-1? So they have a shot, which, you know, can't complain with that outcome with having five of the futures in one region is what we ended up with. But one of the key storylines here, and this is going to be for every Purdue game, but especially in this particular game, is it's very difficult to defend Purdue without fouling. Gonzaga has no depth. They're a bottom five team in bench minutes. A little more front court depth than in the back court, but Edie doesn't just get your front court. Like, they're not – like, you can't guard Edie with, you know, say Ike gets in foul trouble. You can't guard him with just, you know, Ben Gregg. So you got to bring help, right, and other guys get in foul trouble. Can Gonzaga stay out of foul trouble in that game. I mean, how many guys did they play versus Kansas? Seven. Like really buttoned up rotation before the garbage time. That's a big storyline for me. In every game with Edie, he draws so many fouls. Sometimes refs are going to say, we're not blowing the whistle today. And then it's just crazy. Or you can like drape all over them. Sometimes officials are like, we're going to even up the fouls. And then the other team is getting some crazy calls. And then in the bottom half, Tennessee, Creighton, is this another game where, hey, Creighton, ultimately, you're too soft. Get out of here. And Tennessee did survive with a horrendous shooting day. So I don't know if, like, as someone who has a Tennessee future, did that give me, I still don't know, like, did that give me more confidence in Tennessee that they survived a day where they went 3 of 25? They shot 12% from three. So surviving that, I think, you know, that's a good thing. But then again, like, if Connect isn't going off, like, how they're super reliant on him having a big day. Otherwise, you're in a dogfight with Texas. But they did get that game out of the way where they could not make a shot to save their lives. But maybe the physicality of Tennessee is the difference there. Greg, I'll throw it to you. Any quick thoughts?
Yeah, it's my favorite play of this upcoming weekend. Tennessee -2.5. Listen, there are the national title contenders, UConn, Purdue, Houston. And then there is that second tier of teams that we could see it for, right? I think you'd throw Arizona. I think you'd throw Tennessee in there. But those teams have whatever their fatal flaw is. What's going to happen when this happens? Arizona's is what's going to happen when Caleb Love shoots 2 for 20? Well, they're probably going to go home. Tennessee's was what's going to happen if Dalton Connect has an off game. Well, they're probably going to go home. No, they're not. They're still here. Somehow they survived that game. That's new life. They dodged their bullet. He just doesn't have back-to-back bad games. Like it hasn't happened since November, I want to say, or mid-December maybe. I know he had a three straight games in single digits at one point way before the heart of SEC play. It's been a long time. Very, very long time.
Who's stopping him on Creighton? And he
Nobody. Nobody. That's the thing. You have to put Trey Alexander on him, I think. And that's, I mean, he should have 30 in this game minimum, if we're being honest. And you mentioned the physicality. Like, they're going to be overwhelmed at every position. I don't know how Ashworth plays in this game. I know he's been pretty good lately, but Ziegler's going to be all over him. And, on the flip side here, as much as we love Tennessee for all these reasons, is there a more obvious sell shooting regression team left in the tournament than Creighton? Like, the second game, they shot 39% from three and barely beat Oregon, and shot quality had it as a tie against Akron. I love this play. I think you guys are in a great spot with the future with Tennessee. And it's interesting because Purdue looms. Purdue-Gonzaga is an interesting one because Purdue-Tennessee,
please don't give us that game after what we saw in Maui. Oh, my God, that game was unwatchable. There was, I think, Purdue, because Tennessee's so physical, and then, you know, Purdue draws a ton of fouls, rightfully so. There, I think Purdue shot 48 free throws in that game, and Tennessee shot 30. I'm guessing 35. That game was unwatchable.
Yeah, it would be a ref show for sure. And look, there's hope for you with your Tennessee ticket that Gonzaga could pick them off here because, one, Gonzaga's been the third best team in the country since March. They've been awesome. And two, this is a totally different team than they were in Maui. I mean, Dusty Stromer was starting games back then. Now they've got different guys in the lineup. It's a totally different scout. Purdue's essentially the same team that they were in November. I mean, give them credit for being very, very good. It's still hard to game plan for, but they've been Braden Smith, Zach Edey, and a bunch of shooters all season long. It'll be a different challenge. So I think that's going to be a dogfight, very close toss-up style game, and I think Tennessee rolls Creighton.
Fabrice, any final thoughts before we get out of here?
Just a question for Greg. Do you know the good luck charm that was in Rick Barnes' pocket the last time he won a game in the second weekend of the NCAA tournament?
I do not.
I don't know either, but it wasn't an iPhone because it wasn't invented yet. It has been so long since this guy has done anything in the Sweet 16 or Elite Eight. He won one freaking game with Kevin Durant. Like, this guy is the biggest liability in terms of a national championship caliber team because the roster is good enough. Connect is good enough. He's 4-16 against the spread going back to 2009 in the NCAA tournament. They played with their food against Texas. That's a game they should have won by double digits. I understand they couldn't throw it in the ocean. but I'm a little bit concerned about them imposing their will against a Creighton team that, I mean, there's no other way to look at it. They're lucky to be here. They shouldn't have covered against Akron. They should have lost to Oregon, but they still have the pieces, I think, to have, like, when we talk about shooting regression, like, can they shoot 39% again? Absolutely. It's not like they shot like 60% from three against the Ducks. So I think there's a chance that they hang around in this game. If it gets to three or higher, I'm definitely playing the Blue Jays. But I still am not a believer in Rick Barnes to win, you know, critical games deep in March. And as far as the Zags go, I just have to put my hand up. I've been wrong on this team for like 2 months. Like when I was buying them, they were losing. When I was selling them, they were winning. And I agree with your assessment. They're a different roster, the way that they're put together, the rotations, the kind of basketball they're playing right now, as opposed to earlier in the season. But I just don't have a great feel for that game. So that's a pass for me.
Yeah. I mean, I will say in regards to Gonzaga is they have not missed in 2 months. It's a team that's shooting over 40% from three. So does that hit them at any point? But the foul trouble, it's a story, rightfully so, in every Purdue game. Can Gonzaga stay out of foul trouble in that game? It's just going to be a massive point for a team that's bottom 10, bottom five, maybe in bench minutes. But all right. Good stuff, gentlemen. We'll whet everyone's appetite for the Sweet 16. So we have a few days off here. But it's time for us to go break these games down. We will be back Wednesday night with the Sweet 16 betting preview. We will also have live BBOC shows all weekends, to make sure you tune into those starting Thursday, 10:30 a.m. Eastern. But thanks for tuning in. Thanks to Greg and Mike for joining me. Thanks to our producer on the back end. Most importantly, thanks to all of you for tuning in. Make sure you subscribe, unsubscribe, subscribe. Tell a friend, tell an enemy, leave a review, 5-star review. I'll do another batch of giveaways before we get out of here. Thanks for tuning in, and we will see you later in the week. Cheers.